Hello and welcome to Stalwarts of Music with Aditya Veera, Season 2. Today's episode is partnered by Perpetual Buzz Experiences. They are an artist representation company with three very basic but lofty goals. They're the launchpad for artists, helping them leverage success in the best possible manner. They also help fund social causes and make sure that people have a good time throughout the process. So be sure to check them out on www.perpetualbus.com. 2023 has been exciting in terms of music festivals happening in India, and we are witnessing a lot of international acts coming down to our country. I'd like to give a very special shout out for the legend Ronan Keating, who's coming down to Nama Uru and playing at the Bharatiya City Mall on the 18th of November. Get your early bird tickets on Book My Show. Details are mentioned in my bio. Lollapalooza 2024 just unveiled their show dates, and they're happening on the 27th and 28th of January at the Mahalakshmi Racecourse in Mumbai. Grab your tickets on lollaindia.com. Details are in the bio. My guest today is none other than Mr. Stewart Copeland, a man indeed of many hats. He was inducted into the prestigious Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He's been nominated for the Golden Globe Award and has won close to about 7 Grammy Awards, out of which 2 of them were for his musical contributions with Indian maestro Ricky Cage for their compelling record Divine Tides. Stewart Copeland and Ricky Cage have put together another incredible record this year called Polis Beyond Borders. This album is a reinterpretation of some of the classics of the band Polis, with the finest set of musicians from across the world. The album also features contemporaries from India, such as Ayan and Aman, Salim Suleiman, Shankar Mahadevan Ji, and several others. So without any further ado, I'm delighted to welcome my guest for today, Stewart Copeland.
Hello, this is Stewart Copeland, and you're listening to your radio. It's tuned to Stalwarts of Music with Aditya Veera. In fact, this version of it, this episode, could be called Stewart of Music, which is almost the same word as stalwart.
Namaste, Stewart. How are you doing?
Namaste, yourself.
How are you doing?
Very good, thank you.
Which part of the world are you in? Are you at the Sacred Groove Studios?
Yes, I'm at the Sacred Groove in Los Angeles, California, in the Brentwood Hills.
Are you in good rhythm today?
Where are you?
I am in Coimbatore, in the southern part of India, in a state called Tamil Nadu, a little further from Bengaluru. I believe you were there a couple of months back.
Yes, a couple of weeks back.
Okay,
it's all good here. The rhythm is good. Better today than it was yesterday, because when I got back from New Delhi, I had finished a tour in Europe, and I didn't even look at my drums for several weeks, but I've got some shows coming up this weekend, so I've been getting back in shape. So the rhythm is up. Surf is up. Rhythm is up.
That sounds exciting.
Yes.
So I have some very interesting questions as part of our agenda today. Shall we get started?
Let's go.
We're all intimately impacted by our families and the environment that we grow up in. But would you be able to put your finger on specific elements that may have molded you into being Stewart Copeland today?
Yes, there are some obvious ones. One was growing up outside of America in Cairo, Egypt, and Beirut, Lebanon. And the difference of cultural environment means that I make different music.
Sure.
And that's the holy grail that all musicians are looking for, is some kind of difference. And I was surrounded by Arabic music. And there was another hidden benefit of Arabic music in particular, which was that it shares the same rhythmic structure as reggae. And so when reggae hit, I was the skinny white kid who actually had it in my DNA to play those rhythms back to front, with the emphasis on the third beat of the bar and so on.
I'm sure, not just reggae, but, you know, it's when I listen to your music or your signature style, there's so many different elements that come together as one when we listen to it. And, you know, it's very distinct. You know, when someone gets to listen to you on the radio or on a streaming platform, they might just be able to recognize you by your style. And I totally agree with you in terms of, you know, when you said the steward of music, you know, as part of the show, Stalwarts of Music. Yep. I second that. I second that. I'm sure you've answered this question a zillion times. What are some of the gratifications and what is the high that music gives you?
Well, now that is very difficult to, you know, to describe. We all do it. We all do music. And so everybody on the planet, not everybody is Eric Clapton, but all humans do music. We can move our bodies in time to it. We can clap our hands with it. We can sing melody. We're all good at music. And that joy, that spiritual uplift that we get when we're listening to music and making music is available to every human being on the planet. Some of us are bitten by the bug a little more than others, and so we devote our lives to it. And the, you know, the practical side is that music is very rewarding. I get to live in a nice big house and all that. But really, what music does emotionally is available to everybody. And I would say, you know, in India, when I was there last, I played with some Indian musicians, mm-hmm. and they don't call themselves musicians unless they started playing at the age of two and were born into a family, a clan of musicians. Yeah. And so the technique, the skills are so highly developed that I would say to everyone who was not born into a clan of musicians that you too can achieve this joy, this thrill, this ecstasy. Even if you don't have huge skills, you can, you know, just with two chords on a guitar, you can take yourself there. Just with singing in an echoey room can take you there. So this gift is available to everybody. You know, we're not all Eric Clapton, but the gift is available to everybody. That's the most real music. I call it campfire music. You know, college friends send me tapes. Oh, here's me, some of my buddies in the living room. I know you probably think it's really lame, but, you know, what do you think? And I tell them, look, that's the real thing. People sitting in their living room making music, that's the real thing. It's only some later development of human society where we specialize and I get to make the music and you get to listen to it. But really, that's unnatural. The natural state of music is for us all to be making.
Would that analogy still hold good if the person were to be tone deaf?
No, they're not tone deaf. To be truly tone deaf would be an aberration, to be an illness, and very rare. But everybody can carry a tune, more or less.
Incredible. That sounds very promising for anyone
to get into music. And if you can't make it, you can listen to it. My two brothers, for instance, were towering moguls of the music industry, yet neither of them could play an instrument, but they had great ears.
Congratulations on your new album, Polis Beyond Borders. In the press release, you had mentioned that music evolved in Homo sapiens as a bonding social skill. Could you elaborate on that perspective?
Well, I did a series for the BBC asking the question, what is music and why? And I found that music has several different functions and it's evolved. It's an evolved skill that we have. One is sex. It is a precursor to sex. And we know this from looking at the dance floor, people dancing, thrusting their pudenda at each other in public with body language that is explicitly sexual in its messaging is only permissible if there's music playing. You take the music away and that is some weird stuff that people are doing. And music permits this sort of expression, particularly in young people. And so it has that function. But apart from that fun stuff, it's also very important for social cohesion. You know, archaeologists theorize that the reason that Homo sapiens won over Neanderthal, who were much bigger than us, had bigger brains even, they were theoretically smarter than us, but we had music. And, you know, 20,000 years ago, there are musical instruments found in Homo sapiens sites, which meant that they bonded, they made music together. They're so that the result was that us 20 Homo sapiens can kick those five Neanderthals out of the fruit tree. And so this bonding music is very much a part of social cohesion. It brings us together. When we go to church or to temple, the music makes us believe. It's very persuasive. Music bypasses our brain and goes straight to our heart, to our feelings, which is why they paid me the big bucks as a film composer. They put information on the screen, but the emotion comes from the music.
Great. I love the way you articulated this. And you also did mention a little bit about spirituality and something about religious beliefs too. So I'd like to understand, does God take a certain form or shape for someone like you? If yes, what would that be?
Well, one thing we know is that God loves music. Everywhere where there is God, there is music. Every building that is built for God has music. And I've been, I'm not particularly religious myself, but I appreciate the power of music. I've been down in Alabama with the Holy Rollers there. I've been to the New Age Christian church where it's like a U2 concert, but all the lyrics are about Jesus. Even if I'm not necessarily a believer in that specific form of religion, I get it. Everybody in that room is healed, is improved, is forgiven, is made whole. Music is healing and what heals about it is that they're all in a room full of other people also being uplifted, and that there is very, very, it's spiritual nutrient. It's spiritual vitamins and very good for people.
Incredible. I'd like to delve a little deeper into the new release. The ensemble of artists for this release have been meticulously curated by you and Ricky Kitch.
Let me adjust that for a second. Meticulously assembled by Ricky Cage.
Okay.
I made the record. I did the orchestra. I did the backing tracks. I did everything. I made a perfectly good album that went to number 2 in the classical crossover charts. Right. And then Ricky had this idea. Mm-hmm. He said, send me the tapes to Bangalore and let me show you what I can do. Boy, did he show me what he can do. He went down to South Africa and he got the Soweto Gospel Choir.
Yeah.
We got a track from China, from Armenia, all over, various different forms of Indian languages are on this record too.
Exactly. Yeah. So we have, as you rightly mentioned, we have the Berkeley India Ensemble. We have Ayan and Aman. We have Shankar Mahadevanji. And Salim Suleiman and some incredible set of musicians. So I just wanted to understand, how did you go about handpicking these individuals for this pursuit as part of this record? Like, how did the two of you kind of decide as to who does what?
I have a very specific technique for making these decisions. Mm-hmm. Ask Ricky Cage. He did send various ideas to me and we did discuss it. Mm-hmm. But I would have to, the arrangements and everything, I have to give that up, that he really added this whole new dimension to the record. And I've sort of forgotten the original version of it, which did very well out there in the world. But I'm all obsessed with this version now because, I am a creature of I grew up globally, if you like. I was born in America, but I left when I was 2 months old, didn't get back to America until I was 18. Mm-hmm. So although I'm very patriotic, I've always been the American kid. And I've always imagined that America is this wonderful, city on a hill. But actually, I am infused with world culture. And so this album really speaks to me.
You did mention about Mr. Ricky Cage being pivotal in terms of, making this record and deciding and managing things. How did the two of you first meet?
Incoming phone call. He was busy saving the planet. That's another thing that Ricky is good at.
Yeah.
A tree hugger on a global scale, good for the world, as well as being a phenomenal musician. It's amazing that these two things go together. And he sent me a track that I did some percussion drums on, and he went and made the world a better place by use of that track. And then years later, he said, I'm making an album. let's make an album together. And he started sending me these tracks that he had, you know, once again, he assembled these incredible talents and wrote some beautiful music. And immediately, that was an easy one. Yes, I'll do it. And then spent the next month or two obsessing over these tracks. And we sent the tracks back and forth. And I would bang, you know, I'd fired up, mic'd up all my percussion instruments I have around my studio and send them back to him and debate the artistic policy and so on. And so we came up with this album.
So are you going to keep up with
that? That was the Defined Tides album, which we won Grammys 2 years running for the same record.
Yeah. So my question was pertaining to that. So are you going to keep up the streak of winning another Grammy this year too?
You know, that's not why we do it.
No, but
it's a nice, I'm sure the music, if that should happen.
The music is going to speak for itself. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. You know, it's not why we do it. You know, with all the music that I make, and I've learned this kind of late in life. I realized that the journey is the mission. Making it is the mission. What happens when it lands in the marketplace is secondary. The actual process of Ricky sending me this music and me doing stuff and sending it back and, you know, making the music is what it's all about. The mission is actually the journey.
So the destination,
not the destination.
Not the destination. Okay. Makes sense. Of these many hats that you wear, I guess one of the most recent ones was that of you being a podcaster. And I gathered some information on the internet which said in your podcast, you explore your father's penchant for storytelling. So how do you think his storytelling ability influenced your own creativity, both as a musician and a storyteller in your own right?
You got me there. Podcaster? Really? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right. Yes, I did it. I did an audio thing about my father, really. Mm-hmm. It was not my philosophizing or anything. It was basically an audio documentary about my nefarious father.
Yeah.
And what I learned from him is in storytelling was salesmanship.
Okay.
And he was a great raconteur. Mm-hmm. And he and my brother Ian inherited that. In fact, both my brothers inherited this more than me. I just make music. I play music. But my two brothers, they can sell you anything. Mm. And they've got that gift of the gab. The storytelling is a big part of their salesmanship. The Copeland silver tongue, which my brothers excel at much more than me. But I think that's something we got from our father.
Okay. Being siblings in the music industry can create a unique bond and dynamic. So how do you navigate the balance between personal and professional relationships with your siblings, especially when creative differences arise?
Well, as any sibling knows, your relationship with your sister or your brother is both the deepest relationship, but also the most dramatic and fraught with tension and difficulty.
Yeah.
And so on one hand, the three brothers, we knew we could trust each other. We're on the same team. On the other hand, because we know each other too well, we were often at each other's throats. And my brother Miles and Ian, who one was an agent who put the bands out on the road, and the other was a record company guy who put the bands out on records.
Mm-hmm.
They had disagreements often about who they should, you know. Miles said, "What's this band REM? Why am I?" And he said, "Well, if you don't book them, then I'm not booking your band. So and so, you know, squeeze. You know." So they had arguments because they had to work each other's discoveries.
Okay.
And both did rather well. I think Miles reluctantly did very well out of REM.
Right. Having reached the pinnacle of achievement, do you look out for what critiques have to say about your performance the next morning in print or digital media after the performance?
Yes, I do. Because my friends, my team, they're not going to tell me.
Yeah.
And sometimes, even if the critic is hostile, I'm very fortunate that usually they're not hostile, but occasionally somebody will think of something. And I think, you know, I can learn from that. You know, even if I disagree with them, it's interesting to know that someone might have that point of view. And so I do read reviews, not obsessively, but I don't not read them. I know some artists who are afraid to read their own reviews. I'm not afraid because normally they're good and they cheer me up. But if there's a bad one, I learn from it.
Do we get to hear more of Animal Logic anytime soon? There was a reunion last year and you all had put out Can You Tell Me? So can we get to hear, Indian fans would love to hear some Animal Logic.
Well, we're all still friends. And occasionally, Debbie, who's the songwriter of the band, will send a track to Stanley Clark and me. Mm-hmm. So we'll do some stuff on it and send it back to her, and she mixes it and puts out a record. You know, Animal Logic is pretty much Deborah Holland these days. Mm-hmm. But Stanley and I are there, you know, because she writes great songs, and they're always fun to work on. We enjoy each other's company. And it's always fun to have a joint mission.
Anything in the works at this point of day?
Nothing in the works right now, but they'll probably be something.
All right. Your autobiography, Strange Things Happen, offers readers a glimpse into your adventurous life. Can you recount a particularly memorable or exhilarating moment from your travels or experiences? It could be something in India too.
Oh my God. When we played Mumbai, which in those days was called Bombay.
Rang Bhavan.
By the way, I've noticed that in India, everyone still calls it Bombay. Go figure. But it was an amazing experience because it was mainly a photo op. We were not known in India. There was no reason why we should go to India. Mm-hmm. But this nice organization called the Time and Talents Club, these wonderful ladies who bring Western culture to India.
Yeah.
Just, you know, India's got plenty of culture of its own. But why not hear some Mozart as well? And so they took a chance and brought a rock band. I'm sure they'd never heard of him. And so we show up in Bombay, as it was, to play the show for maybe 1,000 people in an open air space. And we start the sound check, and the people on the streets outside hear the music. They think the concert has started. They're climbing over the walls. And soon we've got like something like 4,000 people crammed in. Yeah. The nice people who actually bought tickets didn't have a chance, but we played the show and we had all kinds of complications with the electricity and all those kinds of things back in those days. India was not the modern technological force that it is today. And the people in their native garb from the streets of Mumbai, who'd never heard of the police or even rock music, responded the same way kids respond in Sheffield or New Jersey. It was unbelievable. Sting goes, "Yo!" And the folks go, "Yo!" It was one of the most uplifting, dramatic concerts that we ever played. We were playing to people who had no idea of rock music, and yet they responded in that very emotional way.
We've come a very long way in terms of, curation of concerts, music festivals, and state of art technology being adapted at all of these platforms. So I'm guessing you'll have a much better experience the next time you do a concert in India.
Well, I was amazed the last time I was there a few weeks ago in Bangalore, in Delhi, and just what a difference. Unbelievable stainless steel, just cutting edge technology. I don't know if your listeners realize this, but in America, our top corporations are all run by Indians or of Indian descent. Okay. And it's like, you know, America in the news, we're talking about how, you know, Russia, China, you know, actually it's India that's eating our lunch. And so the difference in what is it, 20, 30, 40 years from when I was there before to today is quite dramatic.
From your African expedition as part of the Rhythmatist documentary, what were some of the issues and ideas that moved you passionately and sought expression in your music during your time there?
I was looking for the origins of American music. Turns out I was looking in the wrong place. The origins of American music are in America, in New Orleans. It came from Africans in America, but the synthesis actually occurred in America. Mm. Never mind. I had a great time in Africa looking for American music. I found African music. Yeah. And in fact, some of the music I found was American instruments arriving back in Africa. You know, these bands in Zaire, in Kenya, and the Congo, playing guitar, bass, and drums, African music on American instruments, which gives us Lingala and all these other kinds of great African music. So the synthesis that occurred in Africa is also very interesting. But I just had an amazing time pretty much crossing Africa along the equator from Kenya, Tanzania, Burundi, Zaire, as it was called at the time, in the Congo, way up the Congo with the pygmy.
In this
there are two Congos.
Right. In this documentary, we see a lot of interesting things that you're doing. You're doing a cartwheel during a traditional African folk song being played. So how do you feel the rhythmic patterns influence physical movements in African dance?
Well, they're all joined. As we were talking earlier, music is the only art form that can physically take over motor control of your body. A painting can't cause you to twitch or move. A book will not induce movement. Music will take you and make you involuntarily move your hips and tap your foot. Music and the body are very much connected. And dance and music, of course, go together very well. So wherever there is music, there is dancing.
On that note, I'd like to play a sneak peek of that documentary for the people of India. Would like to watch a little bit of that. So I'm going to play a little bit of your time in Africa as part of this documentary. That was Rhythmatist, for those of you who haven't watched it, one of the most iconic documentaries I've come across in a couple of years now.
Well, thank you for saying that. There are some very silly parts. We went over to...
of course, that's the fun part, right? Indians like a lot of those extra bits that make it a little more interesting for the viewers, which is just fun.
Well, the director wanted to shoot a feature film, and I wanted to shoot a documentary. And so my good friend JP Dutio and I, who is the genuine article Indiana Jones, he's the real thing, we argued all the way across, you know, about what movie we were making. And basically, for instance, there with those giraffes have nothing to do with the origins of American music or anything to do with music. They're giraffes, but hey, buddy here's got a horse. Let's go ride with the giraffes. That'll make a cool shot. And so I had three glorious days of riding with the giraffes across the Serengeti. But the difficulty was to get the giraffes and me on my horse and the cameras in the same continent, because the giraffes would take off and I'd take off with them over the horizon. And I just had so much fun. It had nothing to do with music, but man, that was three fun days.
Did you like the idea of acting? Did you want to pursue acting as a profession too at some point in your life after this?
The thought crossed my mind, but the good Lord did not give me that gift. I just can't not be myself. And the idea of assuming a role, I'm too egotistical, narcissistic. I don't know. For one reason or another, I'm not able to subsume my internal energies into a role. So I, you know, a couple of times I was in an episode of The Equalizer one time where I had a tiny little role and they just put me in as kind of just a fun thing, and I did not get that gift.
but I'm sure it takes a lot to sort of, you know, rehearse and, you know, get in front of the camera, be comfortable. How did you go about that drill? How did you get accustomed to, of course, you're a performer. You do have a little bit of that experience, but how are you so natural in front of the camera? How are you just being yourself?
Well, I guess I've been doing it for 40 years now. actually 45 years now. Pretty soon it'll be 50 years. Wow. I'm now 70-something years old, and I've been in front of the camera for, let's say, 55 years of it I've been in front of the camera. And before that, I was behind the camera. I was a tour manager. I was a roadie. I was a radio disc jockey. I did a journalist. I did all the other jobs. But playing in the band just kept calling me back, and I kept ending up in front of the camera.
Incredible. What becomes sort of an ambition for a musician of your stature at this time in your life to keep on sort of interpreting what you do as well with a level of variety and excitement that you do things, right? Are there new frontiers to explore at this point in time?
Well, it's a dance that every artist has to do, which is that they do what they started with, and if it's successful, people like that.
Yeah.
And people want them to continue to do that.
Yeah.
And if they change, they lose people. Mm-hmm. In fact, people get angry, you know, go back to doing what you were doing.
Yeah.
And so if they do, they get in a rut and they're stuck there. And that's all they can do is keep thinking of what to do with two guitars and a bass and a drum set forever and ever. And that's got to get stale. Or they branch out and they have different, not the same success, but a more rich artistic life. You know, when I went into film composing, it had nothing to do with being in a rock band. And writing for orchestra, also opera, my God, how irrelevant is that? But I keep changing it up. I'm working on another opera right now. I've written 7, which are performed around the world. And, you know, I don't do film music anymore. It's the same work that I do for opera, but the pay is not as good, but the art is much better.
Yeah. I think that's what is important. That sort of like brings about another question in my head. If you were to consider, you know, artistic integrity versus making money, what would you prefer? What road would you, or what direction would be more important for someone like you?
Well, I fortunately did very well with one of my missions, the police, which gives me the luxury of being able to do other things and not be, you know, I live a quite a simple life. I only have one house. And so that means that I'm not a slave to just churning more money. And many rock stars, they develop a lifestyle that to sustain it, they've got to keep earning the money. And they haven't got time to branch out into other forms of music or art that won't be as successful. They can't afford it. You know, I know musicians who would love to write an opera, but they can't afford it. They've got to go out on tour. They've got to be earning money to sustain their fancy lifestyle. My lifestyle is not so fancy, so I don't have that much to sustain, which gives me the freedom to go with the artistic integrity version.
Fair enough.
A friend of mine wrote a song which had the line, art for art's sake, money for Christ's sake.
Incredible. If you were to talk about digital music, how do you think the whole digital music scenario fits in for the music that you've been putting out? Are you someone who is quite happy with, you know, how artists are being remunerated for their contributions when it's on a streaming platform and things like that?
Well, there's a couple of different questions in there. No, I'm not happy with the remuneration of streaming and so on. It's just not fair. But the other part of the question, which is much more interesting, is that how has electronics, what is the role of electronics in creating music? Yeah. And I'm all for it in two ways. One is that for the first time, the backbeat, guitar, bass, and drums in a backbeat has now been superseded by Kanye, Kendrick Lamar, and all these people who just turn music upside down. So people of my generation say, what is, that's not music. There's no live musicians. Never mind. They use samples, electronic, and they create incredible music, very vital music. Finally, this tyranny of rock and roll is broken by these people who broke the mold and are making something really new. And of course, people my age are going to hate it. That's the point. And so I approve it. And it means also that anybody can do it. Anybody with a laptop can make music. They don't have to be in one of those clans in India starting at the age of two. They can, with a laptop, they can assemble samples. Their fingers are, the only thing their fingers do is hit the alphanumeric keyboard. But still, it's still music. It still moves people. It still communicates. It's still music, even if their fingers are not wiggling and they haven't got that physical dexterity out of it. So it levels the playing field. It democratizes music. You don't need to go to a studio anymore at huge expense. You don't need to go to the man, the record company. You can do it yourself at home on your laptop. Yeah. That means anybody can do it. Unfortunately, that does mean that every damn fool is doing it. So the competition is fierce. Yeah. But I don't care about that. What I do for the listeners, there's incredible richness of music, like Moby, for instance. We would never have that music if it weren't for computers that enabled him to create stuff just by assembling. Yeah. And for me personally, also, the invention of the Fairlight computer, which meant that you could tell a computer what notes to play and it'll play them back for you without me having to be a pianist or a violinist or anything.
Yeah.
That's why I'm an orchestral composer today. That unlocked the whole, you know, orchestral world of music for me was having a machine that I could give it instructions. Because before then I could write a song on the piano and I could play the chords very slowly from one to the next, because I'm not a pianist, but I could either play the right rhythm in the wrong notes or the right notes with no rhythm. And being able to instruct a computer to play that composition just opened up a whole new world. So I'm a big fan of computers in music.
And have you tried the role of AI in terms of your own music? And how successful have you, or how happy have you been with the end result?
No, I haven't tried it in music. I haven't got time to let some machine come in and play with my toys. I'm busy playing on them myself. I'm not stuck for ideas. I one day I'll give it a try. But I do, and don't tell anybody this. I'll share a little secret in India, because you're a long way from my hometown. But I established a routine, a ritual, a tradition, if you like, that every Valentine's Day and Mother's Day, I write a little poem for my wife.
Oh, sweet.
And after our 30 years of marriage, I have exhausted my rhyming dictionary. I love you and the color blue. But now, don't tell anyone I said this. But I now can use AI to write my love poetry. And by the way, it's crap. I have to rewrite it, but it gives me some idea, some rhyming thing, and then I can mess with it and make it personal. But so AI ain't all bad.
Yeah. But do you think it would have the same kind of Stewart Copeland emotions?
Well, that's what I have to do. I have to mess with it. It gives me a template.
Yeah.
And then from there I can mess with it.
Got it.
She would spot instantly if it didn't have my quirky thing to it.
Yeah, for sure. The whole idea of incorporating reggae elements into rock music was quite prominent in terms of your work with the Police. So how did you go about integrating these aspects? What was the impulse behind that?
Well, it came from immersion in Arabic music. It meant that I had that upside down rhythm in my DNA.
Yeah.
And when reggae hit the punk clubs, which is an interesting phenomenon, because in those punk clubs in London, there's no chill punk. It doesn't exist. I mean, it's an impossible concept. So the DJs there, because even punks high on sniffing glue got a chill sometimes. And so they would play hostile dub reggae, which was chill, but still angry.
Yeah.
Suitably angry, but chill. And so all these kids started hearing these reggae bass lines and this reggae musical concept. And that's how the two kind of got joined up. And I would have to give Clash credit for, I think, being the first skinny white English band to attempt to play reggae. But we were all having a go, but our secret sauce was my immersion in Arabic culture.
And you all were pretty darn good at whatever you put out. I must say that. It's made a huge impact all our lives. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, till this very day, if I were to speak, possibly 2 to 3 generations in my family have been listening to that music. And we still love all those timeless masterpieces that you all put together.
Yeah. Yes, yes. You know, it used to be when I was young, you said, wow, my sister thinks you're really hot. Now it's my mother thinks you're really hot. My grandmother thinks you're really hot, which is fine. I like grandmothers. I'm a grandfather.
Incredible.
Give me your phone number.
So what's the next generation up to, like your grandchildren or your sons? What are they up to? Are they still pursuing this musical heritage, taking this forward?
No, in fact, one of my sons has the gift, and actually it's a combination of gifts and skills, a combination of gift and application. Mm-hmm. Only one. And the others are creative. Some of them, you know, one of them's a games designer.
Wow.
For Insomniac. He has a great job there at a computer game company.
Yeah.
My daughter's one's a social worker. Mm-hmm. One, you know, on the streets of Los Angeles, getting homeless people's paperwork done for them and so on. And another is a wolf on Wall Street. Mm. She's my our retirement policy. And so there's a variety of enterprise out there. I have 7 children, 5 grandchildren, and 4 grandpuppies.
That's a huge family.
Oh, so, yeah. So that's my biggest reward. That's my biggest accolade. That's the thing that I've, you know, these awards that I get, I got a shelf full of them over there. I don't even see them anymore. But the family, the children, that gives me joy every day.
Do you hire a caravan when you all decide to go on a picnic?
Yes, in fact, it's complicated. You know, every other Christmas we convene and we have in Christmas, which is next Christmas is in. They're all coming, and then. Okay. The other Christmases, they all go with their other family, with their wives and their other families. So yes, when we all convene, it is a large gathering.
Marvelous.
Oh, and it so fills my heart with joy.
Yeah, I think that's the best part of having such a nice family.
Even though I must say, all of your listeners who are moms and dads, they know that your happiness comes from your most miserable child. You're only as happy as your most miserable child. So even though the others are doing great, there's that one who's got, you know, boyfriend problems or school, whatever, as kids do. And that's your level of happiness is your you know, the unhappiest child.
True that. I'd like to come to the last part of our agenda, which is a fun rapid fire. And I have 5 questions for you, and let's see how you do in terms of the rapid fire.
Sure. See how fast I can answer.
Yeah, yeah. One song that always makes you cry.
Vegetables. How fast was that?
That was pretty fast. Like, right on. Yeah, you nailed that. On the contrary, what is your favorite guilty pleasure song?
Oh, Touch My Bum by some group. I can't even remember their name. Mm-hmm. That they were a 5-minute sensation, one-hit wonder on radio, and their song was "Touch My Bum," and it's so simple-mindedly stupid. Yeah. But I can't, you know. But somehow, you know. Actually, another one, more dignified guilty pleasure, was Fleetwood Mac back in the day when we were all raging punk rockers and rebelling against everything in music. Secretly, we were all listening to Rumors.
Okay, great choice. What is your favorite cuisine?
Not as good as Touch My Bum.
Yeah, nothing beats that. I mean, the title sounds guilty pleasure enough. Yeah. What's your favorite cuisine?
Indian. That's an easy one. Absolutely. Oh, and the amazing thing is that I'm a fan of Indian cuisine because back in the day, in the 70s, the only good food you could have in India, in England, was, you know, on every high street is the Star of India. All this Indian cuisine.
Yeah.
There was more of it. It was tastier. It was more filling. And the English food was famously the worst food on the planet. So Indian food was the best meal you could have. What I'd never realized until I went to India 30 mm-hmm. years ago and was back there just a few weeks ago was that the Indian food that we have here in the West is a tiny sliver of the variety of the options. Yeah. You know, when I was in India a few weeks ago, I just had something completely different every day.
Okay.
But it's just tastier, spicier, and, you know, more healthy as well with all the legumes and everything.
Yeah.
And all the variety of stuff because it's not reliant on meat. Mm. So Indian chefs have, you know, other ways of making their food interesting. So that's an easy one. With a, you know, followed by Italian, which is another whole story, which is the opposite. It's simple ingredients, no spices, just the perfect tomato with the perfect olive oil. And that's all. It's the opposite of Indian food, but I like both extremes.
Any favorite dish that comes to
mind? Oh, anything with lamb and saag.
Okay. If you had to put together...
And masala chai, of course.
Masala chai, discussed. Yeah, I figured that. Yeah, yeah. If you had to put together an all-star rock band, who'd be in it?
Can I have dead people?
Yeah, sure.
Jimi Hendrix, mm-hmm. me. Mm-hmm. Although, how are we going to have Jimi Hendrix and Mitch Mitchell and me? That was my problem as a teenager, fantasizing. Did I fantasize that I'm the guitarist or did I fantasize that I'm the drummer? Because you can't be both.
Yeah.
Okay, Jimi Hendrix. On bass, my buddy I'm playing with right now, Armand Sabaleko. Although Sting did have the advantage of being able to write really great songs. That's useful in a band. Okay, let's go with Sting. Jimi Hendrix on guitar.
Yeah.
That's all I need is three piece.
Okay.
My ultimate band has got three guys.
Yeah. What are the top two qualities of a teacher that you personally embody?
That I embody?
Mm-hmm.
God, I don't know. That's for someone else to answer. If I was a student, the two qualities that I would look for, which was to be interesting,
okay,
keep attention, and to be clear.
All right.
Which means that you derive some benefit from the monologue.
Okay. I have one last question, which is a custom in all of my interviews. And here's a question for you, Mr. Copeland. Down in the distant horizon, what would you like to be remembered as?
A father.
Wow.
That's not very famous. Okay, let me give you... that's what I'm most proud of.
Yeah.
But what will I more likely to be remembered for?
Uh-huh.
As a composer.
Okay. Great answer for a closure. This interview will be additionally aired on Big FM Shillong and Aizawl, two incredible radio stations in the northeastern part of India. And it'll also be part of my YouTube channel, Aditya Veera 1994. And it'll be streaming on all possible audio platforms, ranging from Spotify, Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, name it. I'll be sure to share the link once the interview is out. It's been such an incredible blessing, honor, and a privilege, Mr. Copeland. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I hope you had fun.
I certainly did. Thanks for listening.
Great. Please do stay in touch, and I would love to meet you during your next adventure in India.
Well, I'm going to have to come down south. Everybody tells me that. Ricky tells me I got to go down south. I've done Calcutta, Kolkata. And I've done Mumbai.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to do, you know, starting off with, Bangalore, that's where Ricky is, and then head further south even than that, down to Tamil Nadu.
Yeah, I will take you to the southern tip of India. And
cool.
Yeah.
They say the food's even better down there.
Oh, yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yeah.
Well, they probably say that up in northern India, too.
Well... Everyone's got their way of marketing things.
Well, you know, India is not one place.
Yeah.
Like Africa.
Yeah.
You know, people think of Africa and India as one place. It's not. It's many places.
Correct.
Many different languages, many different cultures with real contrast.
Yeah.
So, yes, there are many of the Indias that I've never seen.
Incredible. So please do stay in touch. I'd love to interact with you and hear from you more often.
Excellent. We'll do that.
All right, then. You take care of your health and speedy recovery. I'd love to see you play somewhere in the world very soon.
We'll come over to Dubai. We're playing over in Dubai in November.
Okay.
That's close.
Okay, yeah, sure. Why not? So you're doing this tour with the Deranged Orchestra, or you're doing it with the Police Beyond Borders lineup?
Well, it's kind of both. You know, Ricky will be there, and we will bring some elements of Beyond Borders. But it's the Lovely. UN COP23. It's a UN event in Dubai, and they're hiring up the Dubai Symphony.
Oh wow! Oh, that'll be massive. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a big show.
Incredible. Incredible. Awesome. So you take care then. I'm not going to take too much of your time. I know you have a lot of important things to look into. So I'm going to let you go.
All right. Thanks a lot. Thanks for listening.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye now.